I look back on my life, the summer of 1995, probably the most enjoyable memories I have. I spent that entire summer at my guitarist's house, in his basement apartment, just jamming, talking about music, and listening to music. And that's all we did. Now, we were only in junior high, but my friend was kind of a rich kid, and his parents had turned their basement into an apartment, this huge apartment just for him, and he had thousands of dollars worth of band equipment. And that's all we did every day. Now, there had been rumors circulating that the drummer from Nirvana, Dave Grohl, had formed his own band, and they were even going to soon begin touring. Ryan had satellite TV, and we were watching a Canadian music station when on the screen comes the Foo Fighters. I think for the most part, we were expecting some form of a continuation of Nirvana. Dave Grohl to be on drums, and Chris Novoselic to be on bass. But when the video started, the very first shot of the video purposefully shows you that Dave Grohl is not the drummer. It's the only music video I've ever seen where the first shot is of the drummer. And that was a little message to you saying, nope, Dave's not the drummer. Then it moves to the bassist. Nope, Chris Novoselic isn't on bass. Then Dave Grohl. And you're like, holy shit, Dave Grohl plays guitar and he can sing and he's got a good grungy screaming voice. I didn't know any of this. Personally, I accepted the Foo Fighters for what they were right from the start. That very first time I saw that very first video, I'll stick around. Perhaps it was because I was then and still am now a drummer who also plays a guitar. But a lot of people did not accept what Dave was doing. He had a very hard time in the beginning. There was a lot of skepticism. Imagine living within the shadow of Kurt Cobain and then trying to step out from that shadow and become a frontman. A lot of people weren't having it. So in Foo series number one, I want to talk about the formation of the Foo Fighters. Of course, we're not going to be able to talk about the formation of the Foo Fighters without getting into Nirvana territory, but I don't think my viewers are really going to mind if I cross-reference Nirvana in a Foo Fighters video. Ladies and gentlemen, Foo Fighters series number one has been sponsored by creator, writer, author, professor, sci-fi thriller genius Alan Thompson and his new book series that has just launched called Creation Abomination. Creation Abomination is a supernatural sci-fi thriller book series. It has to do with cloning, good versus evil, has ethical issues, and it gets super creepy. It occurs present day and is based on accurate science. There are tons of supernatural events, from demonic possessions to angelic interventions, but the book still relies on accurate science, and that's one thing that really intrigued me. The premise of Creation Abomination is the main character, William, trying to figure out how to heal injuries to the human body that are normally irreparable, like brain damage, using adult stem cells. This doesn't work, but he is able to figure out that embryonic stem cells, or ESCs, will work. Now, there's a catch. ESCs have to come from the same person that is in need of healing. This is totally impossible because ESCs only exist for 18 hours when an embryo is first formed and then they change. So William concludes that he needs to create a human embryonic clone of that person, harvest the cells from the embryo, which unfortunately destroys the embryo in the process. This is where the story takes off. As you can tell from the storyline, there are a lot of big issues packed in here. Things like, can we create human life? And if we do, would that life have a soul? Well, guess what? They do have a soul. It's just not a soul that you want in your living room. Creation Abomination is action-packed, and you'll find yourself sleeping with the lights on. I found book one of Creation Abomination series to be intriguing and very thought-provoking. There is a moral dilemma between the lines of this story, and depending on your opinion, you'll find yourself on one side of the fence or the other. head on over to creationabomination.com/subscribe/. You can sign up for a free newsletter and a chance to win a free poster. Along with this book series comes some pretty amazing art. As you can see, we have multiple posters, scenes from the books you can choose from, as well. We also have t-shirts, numerous t-shirts to choose from. Show your sci-fi thriller side. Go on over there, check it out, and become a new member of the Creation Abomination newsletter. You can win a free poster. You got nothing to lose. Go on over there, subscribe to the newsletter for your chance to win a free poster from Creation Abomination. All links to Creation Abomination will be in the description below. Let's go ahead. Let's get started with some Foo Fighters.
I'm not the most vocal person in the world, but it'd be silly to say that it doesn't feel like there's something missing, and I think about Kurt every day.
5 months to the day after Kurt Cobain's body was discovered at his Lake Washington home, September 8th, 1994, we see a new side of Dave Grohl. Now, this isn't the first time we've heard from Dave Grohl. He spoke in interviews before. However, this is the first time we see Dave assuming the leadership role. In Nirvana's early career, Chris acted as the leader. He took control of most of the interviews. Even the famous newscaster interviewer Kurt Loder from MTV described Kurt Cobain as very shy and happy to reserve himself in the background. The first time he interviewed Nirvana, he said Kurt almost didn't even speak the entire time. As Kurt became more comfortable with his success, we started to see him emerge. The interest was on Kurt and his lyrics and his riffs. And after Kurt, we see that leadership role shift to Dave Grohl. Dave describes for us how he felt after Kurt's death and how long it took for him to even pick up a pair of drumsticks.
After Kurt died, I didn't want to play music. I didn't want to play the drums. At some point, I was finally motivated. Ugh, I'm gonna get myself out of this funk I've been in for the last 8 months or whatever it was.
For nearly a year after Kurt Cobain's death, Dave is so upset that he can't even pick up drumsticks. For Chris Novoselic and Pat Smear, even longer.
When Kurt died, it wasn't just that my friend died. It was my whole life kind of died around it and with him, you know? And I quit the music business.
Kurt's bandmates, Dave, Chris, and Pat, have went into a time of mourning, and they have become so unsettled and so dejected with the loss of their friend that they're quitting the music business. Meanwhile, the person with the most access to Kurt, the person who's supposed to be closest to Kurt, well, her career's just taking off. Kurt's wife, Courtney, insists that her album be released 1 week after his death, even though the record company opposed it and thought it was in poor taste. At the least, they wanted her to change the name of the title, Live Through This, to something more appropriate for this period of time, knowing that Courtney will inevitably be executor of the Cobain estate. Geffen can't do much about it. She insists that it be released, and only 3 weeks after Kurt's death, she has hooked up with Billy Corgan, who is helping her write future album, Celebrity Skin. While Kurt's own bandmates are going through a time of mourning, his wife is more worried about her budding career. However, a tiger's always going to show its stripes. A musician has got to perform. Several months have went by, and Dave decides to get out of the house and go record some music.
I decided that I was going to take my favorite songs that I had written over the last 4 or 5 years that no one had heard, and I was going to record them at a 24-track studio down the street from my house. I didn't know why I was doing it. I just wanted to do something, you know?
during this time that Dave's recording at Robert Lang Studios, Nirvana fans are surprisingly shocked to see Dave Grohl perform at the end of 94, well after Kurt's death, on Saturday Night Live with a living legendary rock star, Tom Petty. Tom is in between drummers. His drummer has quit on him. Who does Tom decide to call? Hey, what's that boy's name from Nirvana? I like him. Let's get in touch with him. Go ahead, give him a call, see if he'll drum for us on Saturday Night Live.
In the middle of that session, I get a call at the studio that Tom Petty wants me to come play drums for him on Saturday Night Live. I just thought, oh my God, he's a hero of mine. And I had the opportunity to join the band if I wanted to join the band. I really had to kind of choose. Was I going to play drums with Tom Petty? Or was I going to start over from scratch and be the lead singer and guitar player of a band, do something I'd never done before?
Dave finally starts to feel better. He wants to get back to doing what he does best, and fortune smiles on him. Tom Petty calls him and says, dude, I'm already a successful act. You can be the drummer in my band. Imagine the courage that it must have taken for Dave Grohl, who'd never been a successful frontman, who'd never sold one single album with songs on it that he wrote himself, to say, I'm gonna turn down Tom Petty and I'm gonna do my own thing. Keep in mind that in 1994, Last Dance with Mary Jane came out. Tom Petty just won an MTV Music Award for that video as well. He was on the top of the charts with Nirvana.
The Video Vanguard Award goes to Tom Petty.
Believe me, man, it was not easy to tell Tom Petty that I wasn't going to be his drummer. It was not an easy decision to make. I could still see my hand just putting the phone down and thinking, okay, let's see what happens.
Little did we know, Dave Grohl had actually been writing and recording his own songs for many years, and his cassette tapes were very popular within the underground.
Dave was always like a really, you know, he was always a good sort of pop punk songwriter. Even before he was in Nirvana, he did these cassettes that were very popular in the underground.
Dave goes down the street from his house to Robert Lang Studios in Seattle. He plays every instrument. He records the very first Foo Fighters album, self-titled Foo Fighters, and that is what we get. Although the video my friends and I watched shows an entire band, it was actually Dave who recorded all the music by himself. I recall my bandmates and I rejoicing at the fact that Pat Smear was in the band, but there was no Chris Novoselic, and we thought to ourselves, when the hell are these other guys that are in the band, and where did Dave Grohl find them?
There's a band in Seattle called Sunny Day Real Estate, and a good friend of mine told me that Sunny Day Real Estate were playing a show and that it was going to be their last show because they were breaking up.
My band was falling apart at about the same time that that Dave found himself without a band.
We were broken up while we were doing the tour. We decided that we weren't going to do it anymore, but had already booked this tour, so we were like, well, this will be the last whatever thing we do.
I went to this show to see them play, knowing that it was probably the last time anyone was gonna see them play. And I was watching them thinking, that's a really good rhythm section. I gave them the cassette thinking like, hey, check it out. Maybe we could jam sometime.
It's 1995. Although Kurt Cobain has passed away, Nirvana is still at the absolute peak of popularity, and the drummer approaches you and says, hey, I got this cassette. It's a demo of a new band I want to form. You want to check it out? Maybe we could jam sometime. What do you think they're going to do? They're not going to throw the cassette away. They're immediately going to find a tape player, stick it in, and say, yes, I want to join, as soon as it starts playing. Actually, before it even starts playing, they're going to say, yes, when can we jam? Want to come to my mom's house? And they do actually end up jamming for the first time at William's mother's house. It's kind of funny if you think about it. Dave Grohl, most popular band in the world, access to any studio in the world, he goes to jam at his drummer's mom's house.
I remember the first time that Nate and William and I got together to jam. It was over at William's parents' house.
I remember going up to William's parents' kitchen and sitting there after we played, and Dave just goes, you guys want to be in the band? And I was like, hell yeah.
Playing in front of people, it was very difficult for me. I did have a conversation with Dave, and I said, you know, man, I don't think that I should do it. And Dave said, that's exactly why you're the guy that has to do it. And I don't know what that meant, but that convinced me, I guess.
Talk about being at the right place at the right time. Nate and William win the freaking lottery, in my opinion. The only key component left, Pat Smear. Pat flies up from LA. Dave plays him the tape. He's in.